talk about Jamal Baptiste and also some of the players we've been linked with in the Championship. I just want to talk about Souček before I do that, and in particular, Souček's connection with the fans. And this clip, which I'll probably pop up there, I won't be able to play much of it because it's not really my footage. You're not really meant to do it. But there's something called fair use, so I can nick a little bit of it just to demonstrate that. What I think is a wonderful, wonderful part of what's going on at West Ham at the moment, which is a massive connection between the fans and the players, a massive connection between the coaching staff and the players. And it just feels like there's a massive, well, just a feel-good factor, really, at West Ham. And I love seeing that. I love seeing the player interaction with the fans. I really do. I saw something else involving another player, actually, from another team. I don't know why I'm being all secretive about it. It was Richarlison, and he went and celebrated the fans, and then there was a little bit afterwards where you actually thought he couldn't wait to get away from the fans. And I just thought it was quite stark, and it was quite telling when you look at what Souček was doing there. So basically he goes in, he gives his shirt to one of the fans, and after that, everybody wants to shake his hand, and you can understand that. And what he does, he runs along the side of the pitch, basically high-fiving everybody, which, you know, you've got a lot of time to shake everyone's hand, have you? But high-fives everyone, and not because he feels that he should do or he's meant to. In fact, quite the opposite. There's a West Ham United employee trying to pull him away and stop him from doing it. We'll get to that in a second. But not because he's told to, but because he wants to. And you can see the smile on his face as he's thoroughly enjoying it. He is really enjoying it. And fair play to him, you know. I just think it's marvellous, particularly when you've got that big disconnect between the edge of the front row of the seats and the start of the pitch. It's really important that players go over there and sort of get involved with the fans. Ben Johnson certainly did it during the game, as I mentioned in the previous video. Declan does it a lot for now. So there's a lot of players that go over and do that, and I think it's really important that it's done. The member of staff, he's a West Ham employee. You know, I'm sure he's a lovely fella. But he's the guy in the mask in the video, and he can't wait to get Souček away. You know, he's almost, you can see he's nervous about Souček giving the shirt. He's nervous about Souček having any interaction with the fans. Do you know what? I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say it's a COVID thing, maybe. But you get the impression if it wasn't a COVID, he'd be there trying to, you know, stop Souček. And we've seen it before. Do you remember that footage I had where Ginger Pele climbed into the crowd?
Unbelievable, every game. What a man, what a player. Proper West Ham. He loves it. He's right in with the fans.
I just look at it and I think, mate, he's fine. Souček's fine. He's a, number one, he's a big boy. Number two, you've not gauged it correctly. If you think any of the West Ham fans want to harm Tomáš Souček, you've not gauged it at all. And you can see he's trying to stop him from sort of high-fiving everyone. Just calm down a little bit, mate. It reminds me of the... I don't watch much of the darts, but the darts in recent years has had a sort... It's all got lots of razzmatazz. The darts has got very WWE, if you notice. Certainly from my time of initially watching people like Bobby George and whatnot. And what happens is there's now these burly bodyguards there. So what happens is every player's got a song now. So they have like a walkout. They treat them like boxers, I guess. Well, I guess like WWE. So the tune starts playing. The fog start, the smoke and all the pyrotechnics start up. And then they sort of walk out from this curtain, the darts players, but it's burly, there's this row of burly security guards, they're like that, keep back, and they're trying to keep everybody back, but no one's actually trying to do anything. And the funniest ones I ever saw was, I don't really watch it anymore, but it must have been Phil the Power Taylor, I'm pretty sure it was, because I don't really watch it since he's retired anyway, but there was this big burly bodyguard, big burly bodyguard there, and Phil's trying to walk through, and there's this, I don't know, basically, it looked like an old girl, right, it looked like an old pensioner there, it was clearly there, and she had this pen, and she had this bit of paper in her hand. It was so obvious to one and all that she just wanted Phil Taylor's autograph. Now, it's not that, you know, Phil doesn't have to be signing autographs, at this point, he's probably focused and just wants to concentrate on the game. But the ferocity, the guy was tensing his arm, like this. Like, there was some was all. Do you know what? It was almost like they were the world's strongest man was behind him trying to force his way through. And there was this old girl. Oh, excuse me, Phil. Can I have your autograph, please, darling? You know. Oh, you get me. Do you know? Oh, it just. You know what they're like. These people. The old high vis jacket brigade. You get them. Seeing them around. Oh, sorry, I'm waffling. See them around at the moment. Actually, when you go into the supermarket, because it's Christmas time and spaces are at a premium. And they're there with this like lollipop stick, and it says a parking space here. And my one, there's like a Marks and Spencer's and a Tesco all together, and there's a garage. It's like this complex thing, and there's parking spaces everywhere. I mean, it's thousands of parking spaces. And there's someone in a fire hybrid jacket. Come on. All right, mate. Can't. I'm just gonna park in. Mate, I can. There's 50 parking spaces in a row in front of me. Come on. There. And he's trying to usher me in. Keep driving. All right, mate. You know, crikey. You know, keep going. Okay, stop, mate. You know, come on. I know how to park me motor. Honestly. Anyway. Sorry. What a ridiculous waffle. Anyway, what was I talking about? Jamal Baptiste. He's being spoken of so highly, and I mean really, really highly, isn't he? And I look at it now, and I look at particularly some of the players that we have been linked with, and I think, if he doesn't get a chance now, when does he get a chance? Now, when I say highly, let me just explain quite how highly he's rated. Okay, I think he's just this, reading through all the literature that I have done, I think he's the second youngest player to have represented the under-23, so a truly outstanding talent. I think he represented his England age groups. He's always younger. So you get the idea. I might have it slightly wrong, but you know what I mean? He represents England under 17s when he's 16s, so on and so forth. He's always an age group above where he should be, in represents. Everybody says he's got absolutely everything. You know, he models his game on a cross between Virgil van Dijk, and it's quite funny, I read it. Virgil van Dijk, Rio Ferdinand, and Matthew Upson. I joke, it's because Matthew Upson helps with our coaching and has played a part in his development. But not three names you'd take together. I hope he hasn't taken PR lessons from Rio, though. That's all I would hope on that. But this is the type of standing in the game that you look at. And he's a big boy, apparently, a tall lad, very fast. And apparently the physical attributes are not a problem. He's ready to play in men's football now. In terms of skill, very, very skillful, technique, time of the tackle. Everything you hear, he's outstanding at every age group he's played at. And I really feel it's important for him to start getting games now. I totally understand the purchase of Dawson. I really do. I think it was a wise purchase to get this player in initially on loan, and then we got him for whatever it was, 2 or 3 million. He's been a massively successful sign in terms of value. I would suggest Dawson at 2.5 million, let's call it 2.5 million, might have it slightly wrong, is just as good a value as, I don't know, Bowen at 20 million or something like that. Comparatively, bearing in mind he probably cost 10% of what Bowen did, does he produce 10% of what Bowen does? Well, yes, you know, I think he's a really, really good one. So I understand the need for getting him in, particularly at the moment, but it's really important with these young players that you don't just say they have a path to the first team, you give them a path to the first team. Because if I was, I'm saying Baptiste now, I know you could say Alisi, but I'm using Baptiste as the example here. Because he's the one being talked up as the next big thing. He's the one being talked up as sort of the best young centre-back in the country sort of thing. And even Terry Wesley, Terry Wesley obviously used to be in charge of our academy. The reason I even Terry Wesley is that academy coaches are very keen to talk players down. The reason they want to talk players down is they want to don't put too much pressure on their shoulders. And I get that. So you know when they do talk a player up, you're probably dealing with someone very, very special indeed. I think this is what we're doing. And I think if you're that player and if you feel that you are physically ready, if you feel that you've played well in every level that you've basically featured in up to first team level, and you get to a point where the two main centre-halves, which for us are, which are obviously Ogbonna and Zuma, are out, you're probably want to be thinking, well, I would like to be getting on the bench here. And I think it's important we start to see that happen. And I really do want to see him feature, because what we don't want is a situation whereby It's actually funny. It's a Jadon Sancho situation. And for those of you that don't know, I think Jadon Sancho signed, I think possibly he was at Watford, signed for Man City as the next bright young talent coming through. And he just couldn't get a game at Man City. And in the end, Dortmund came in and said, we'll play you. In the same way that they've done with Jude Bellingham, albeit differently because Bellingham was playing at Birmingham City. Man City was playing at such a high level and such a good team, they didn't have the time or the facility to allow Jadon Sancho to develop. So he went and developed somewhere else, and it was actually, I think they ended up selling. I think they sold it to Dortmund for 7 million, something like that. And in the end, Dortmund ended up getting whatever it was, 75, 80 million for him. So I think we've got to be mindful that something like that doesn't happen with Baptiste. You've got to give him encouragement. You've got to give him a pathway to the first team. It's really, really important. I think now is the time. I do agree what we did in the preview with Charlie when he said he doesn't think that Moyes will pack out the team completely with youngsters. I agree, but I think one of the positions we probably should play a youngster would be at centre-half because we don't seem to have any, and we really should be wrapping Diop and Dawson in Cottonwell. Lose one of them, and we are in trouble. And I think they should be starting all of the games until we get to January. But my point is, you know, in these games in the Europa League, give Baptiste a chance. Let's just give him a little go, shall we? I also think, you know, possibly what we don't want to do is bring in another player that would block his pathway. So I think it's all right bringing in a centre-back on loan. I think that makes sense. What you don't want to do is bring in someone else who, perhaps a young centre-back looking for the long term, because Baptiste might look at it and he might say, well, hold on, Ogbonna might come back from injury and play for another year or two. Zuma's there for the long haul. Diop is no shift in him. You don't want Baptiste to see five or six players in front of him and think, do you know what, I'm gonna do a Jadon Sancho and bugger off elsewhere. Anyway, that's it. I haven't really, do you know what, I'll just mention the other players actually, just very, very quickly. Sorry, I've dragged on a little bit. It's because I was talking about high-vis jackets and jobsworth for so long. I just want to go into it. Okay, this is, actually we'll leave that player. Okay, for those of you who don't know, Derby County are about to go into administration. Right, or the administrator has already been put in place. Not sure. It's either happened or they're very close to it, which basically means which means Derby County are going to lose their assets. And Derby County have had a rough old time, make no mistake about it, are going to lose their assets for a pittance, because it's not the administrator's job to come in and really look at future values of players. It's not an administrator's job to come in and think, well, hold on, there's a midfielder, he's promising, and we might sell him for £3 million now, but in 4 years he could be worth 20. Let's nurture him. That's not an administrator's job. That's not what they'll do. They'll take the £3 million. That's what they'll do. And then what they'll do is they'll make agreements to Derby's creditors, and they'll basically turn around and say, OK, well, look, I don't know what the standard sum is, but you've heard the term before, 10p in the pound. So basically, if Derby owe you a pound, they say, well, we ain't got a pound, we'll give you 10p, or whatever the case may be, in every pound. It's for the administrator to get money in. Now, the reason I say this, apparently you're looking at three players, and this was it. We've been linked with somebody called Jason Knight, but then it's not quite content with, we're going in for Jason Knight, who may or may not be a good player. Don't know anything about him. Apparently, he's quite promising. But then also, we've had a look, and apparently there's a guy called Max Bird, who's a midfielder and a left-back, Lee Buchanan. And the rumour is that we're looking at all three. And whilst, I don't know, it just don't sit that comfortably with me. You know, I think I look at a club like that, and that could so easily have been West Ham. It really could so easily have been West Ham. You can imagine how we'd feel as fans if we had players that were worth a lot more and people started cherry picking and basically asset stripping. And look, the administrator's got to do it to keep the club going. But I really hope we don't stitch Derby County up, really. And it was funny, I just do think you have to act decently in this, because it's such a cutthroat world, football. So I'm not saying don't go in again and get Jason Knight, but don't go in and take a quarter of their first team and not remunerate them correctly, because they were decimated anyway. They're already using the youngsters. I was going to say poor old Wayne Rooney. I don't feel sorry for Wayne Rooney per se. Never feel sorry for a man that's got a yacht, as they say. But you know, as a club, for the Derby fans, I do feel for them a little bit, really. So, yeah, I hope they don't go to the wall. I hope the administrator's a little bit sensible with what he's doing. That being said, if 20-year-old Jason Knight is a wonderful player and can help improve West Ham, let's get him in. But let's not, you know, let's not give him a packet of Jaffa Cakes and a Curly Whirly. Let's give him the money that he may well, you know, let's give him... If he's worth 5 million, let's give him 5 million, so at least they can sort their bloody club out. We've got enough. What we got? 2 or 3 billionaires in charge of our club. Surely we can afford it. Anyway, that's it. Bit of a weird video today, really, isn't it? Got this fluffy jumper. Sorry, I keep scratching my neck. It's itching me. Basically, it's a bit fibrous. It's a bit furry. It's a bit wispy. A bit fluffy. Anyway, I'll be back tomorrow, probably talking about... I probably won't tomorrow. I'll be talking about high-vis jackets and overly officious parking attendants and burly security guards trying to stop old grannies from attacking Phil Taylor. Phil the Power Taylor is his name. Phil the Power... I don't think he was christened that. I think it was just his moniker. I think he was given that one. But Phil the Power indicates that he could probably take care of himself. And even if nothing else, if the old granny was really just... Oh, Phil... He's got darts. He could... No, I don't. By the way, I don't endorse any granny attacking a darts player. And I certainly don't endorse any darts player stabbing a granny with his darts. My goodness, this has taken a funny turn.